Okay, I think we can get started for now. So, hi everyone, welcome to the Columbia Public Health. This is a general admissions presentation. My name is Armani Wilson, I'm an admissions officer and I will be giving you the presentation today. So we're gonna launch a poll really quick just to get a sense of who's in the space and where you guys are from and what you're interested in. So if you could just take a minute to answer the poll. While you guys are answering, I'm gonna give you a quick rundown of today's agenda. So we're gonna go over a quick overview of the School of Public Health. We're gonna talk about our mailman community and the careers our students go into. We're also gonna touch on the programs that we offer, our admissions requirements. We're gonna briefly touch on some funding and scholarship opportunities we offer. And then we're gonna end with a student panel with one of our students who was kind enough to lend her time to us today. And then we will conclude with an open Q&A. I will say I have some colleagues in the space with me that will help answering questions in the chat. However, please save your questions until the end of the presentation during the open Q&A session, because more than likely, most of your questions will be answered by the presentation. Okay, so it looks like most of the poll has come in. So let's take a look at the results. So it looks like most of you are from North America, and no surprise, most of you are interested in our MPH program, which is our most popular program. Departments, it's widespread, and most of you will be applying for fall 2022. So you've come to the right place. I'm gonna give you as much information as you guys need. Okay, so. There we go. Okay, so a quick overview of our school. So the Columbia Mailman School of Public Health was founded in 1922, which means that we are about to celebrate our centennial year, 100 years of educating public health professionals. It's very exciting. We are located on West 168th Street in New York City, in the Washington Heights neighborhood to be specific. So we are not located on the downtown campus that a lot of people are a bit more familiar with, but you do have access to the facilities on the downtown campus. There are libraries, et cetera, we do have access to them as a Columbia student. We typically have about 1,500 students enrolled. Around 87% of these students are master students and 13% are doctoral. We are consistently ranked number 4 in the U.S. News and World Report among public health schools. Our students come from all 50 states and over 50 countries worldwide, and of these students, around 46% identify themselves as a student of color. We also are associated with over 20 centers and institutes around the world, and we have over 500 faculty members who are experts in their field. So student engagement. So at Mailman, you have a lot of opportunities to be engaged on campus. So we offer 26 active student organizations that are all public health focused, and they offer academic activities, professional development activities, social events, etc. They also offer over 150 student leadership roles among these organizations. So these could be graduate student associations, positions, student organization leaders, or things like the RISE Peer Mentorship Program, tons of opportunities for you to get a leadership role. These organizations, like I said, do offer a lot of events, over 200 events during the academic year. And it's not just academic events or professional events, it's also just fun events like going to Broadway shows or going to Yankee games. It's really just opportunities to engage with your peers as well and learn more about the people that are in your field and people that you're most likely to be working with after you graduate. So we have an Office of Diversity, Culture, and Inclusion, which supports the school's mission to create an inclusive and equitable campus community. So they offer an array of programs and initiatives throughout the year to support our anti-oppression work. So some of the programs that they offer are the Self, Social, and Global Awareness series, which is actually a series that is required of all of our students. So it's essentially a series where you learn about health equities and health disparities among different communities. And it is a requirement for all of our students. They also offer other programs like the RISE Peer Mentor program that I mentioned earlier, which is essentially geared towards supporting our first generation students and kind of helping them with their acclimation to graduate school life. Another initiative they actually recently launched in June 2020 was the Forward Initiative, which is Fighting Oppression, Racism, and White Supremacy Through Action, Research, and Discourse. So this initiative focuses on improving our curriculum content, recruiting, mentoring, and retaining faculty and students of color, and increasing our community engagement, so helping the community around us. So I really encourage you all to look into the Office of Diversity and Inclusion on the website and look at the resources that they offer, because they are a very important part of our school. Another office that's very important to our school is the Office of Careers and Practice. So they are who are going to help you with your practicum. So as students in the MPH program, the MHA program, and the DRPH program, you are required to complete a practicum. And this practicum is essentially where you're going to be applying the academic knowledge that you're gaining in your classes. So it's really just translating your curriculum-based knowledge to an applied public health context. So a lot of our students do their practicum in New York City. However, we also offer a global health certificate, which comes with a practicum abroad. And again, the Office of Careers and Field Practice help you to find those practicums and basically get you all situated with that. So you're not completely alone finding your practicum. We do help you. So some postgraduate outcomes. So where do our graduates go after they leave Mailman? So we have a very high success rate in terms of our students coming out of Mailman and being employed. So around 87% are immediately employed right after graduation. And then about 8.2% go on to continue their studies, whether that's towards a doctoral program at Mailman or at another school. Some students do go that route as well. In terms of where our students are employed, they're really all over the map. So while 31% of our students go into hospital and healthcare, we also have students going to government and nonprofit organizations and marketing and consulting. So really public health, it's not just, if you're not pigeonholed into just the hospital and healthcare, you can really go in a variety of different fields. In terms of where our students go, so for the most part, around 71% of our students do stay in the New York area, because honestly, once you come to New York, it's really hard to say goodbye to it. So a lot of our students do choose to stay in New York. However, we do have some students that go throughout the rest of the country, and even internationally, they begin their work after leaving Mailman. Oh, I skipped a stop. There we go. So how do these students get to where they get to after graduation? So a big part of that is our Office of Career Services. They offer career advisement for resume reviews, mock interviews, and even help you to figure out how to negotiate your salary. They also offer workshops on job searching, networking, etc. They also have an online resource known as Career Link, which offers job board postings and tips. And then they also offer 2 career fairs per year, which each has over 70 employers at each one, so you can meet employers and network yourself. Then they also have networking mixers where current students meet with alumni, and just they offer a lot of resources for our students. Then we have the housing office. So I know a lot of people are really concerned about housing in New York City, because it's New York City, you know, housing can be a little daunting, but we do offer on-campus housing. So we have 4 buildings that are located on the Mailman School of Public Health campus. They offer a variety of different housing options there. We also offer off-campus housing, off-campus housing assistance. So we will help you to look at apartments, and we'll guide you with the rental process as well. So now into the degrees and programs that we offer. So like I said, we offer the Master of Public Health program. It's our most popular program. We offer it in 4 different formats. So we have it in a 2-year full-time format, which includes a certificate component. We also offer it in an accelerated 1-year program, 1-year format, a dual program, an executive program only in the Health Policy and Management Department. And then we also offer the Master of Healthcare Administration degree. We offer that in a 2-year full-time format, a part-time format, and an executive format, again, only in the Health Policy and Management Department. We also offer a Master of Science degree. We offer it in a full-time format and a part-time format. And recently we started offering it in an online format, but only in the Department of Epidemiology. We also offer a PhD program and a DRPH program. So once you've picked your program, what program you want to apply to, you're going to want to pick your department. So we offer 6 departments. So going from left to right, we have biostatistics, environmental health sciences, epidemiology, health policy and management, population and family health, and socio-medical sciences. So this is just a brief snapshot of what each department really focuses on, what you can expect each department to kind of encompass. So when you apply, you're picking both your degree and your department. You cannot apply to us as an undecided department because the people reviewing your application are only the people from the department that you're applying to. So when you apply, let's say you're applying as an MPH in health policy and management, then your application is going to be reviewed by the health policy and management department. So you want to make sure that your application is really geared towards that department and that you really know that's the department that you want to go into. So I strongly encourage going on our website and looking at the department pages and really reviewing the departments and what they offer and seeing where your interests really align. So in terms of the different MPH programs that I briefly mentioned earlier, we're gonna go into in depth with those a little bit. So the 2-year full-time program is our most popular program. It's what most people apply to. So it is a 2-year program and the first semester is the core curriculum. It's our interdisciplinary core. So this is where you're really gonna be taking classes with students from other departments, with faculty from other departments. It's the most interdisciplinary part of your studies at Columbia. After the core, you will be taking classes that are more geared towards your department and you're really just be with your department and your department faculty and your department students. You also have the practicum, as I mentioned, in the summer, and then you will go on to your certificate component, which is what is really unique about the Columbia Public Health Program is our certificate component. Because even though you are in a single department, you do choose a certificate which allows you to really narrow your niche in public health and really get a focus on a particular thing that you're interested in. So we do have a wide range of certificate options. We have about 20 certificates that we offer. You're going to want to look into each certificate and see which one you're really interested in. However, you do not have to apply to your certificate when you apply to your program. So you can apply as an undecided certificate because most people do choose or switch their certificate after their first semester. So you don't have to be sure about your certificate when you apply, but it is a good idea to really look into it. Oh, should also mention certificates only for the 2-year MPH, not the other MPH programs. So the accelerated MPH program is a 1-year program. It is the accelerated version of our 2-year program. So 1 year long, basically just faster track MPH. You don't have a certificate component with the 1-year program and your practicum is not completed on its own during the summer. It's completed while you're still taking other classes. So it is a more rigorous course. And because of that, it is really designed for professionals who already have a doctoral degree or a nearly completed doctoral degree or a master's degree and or 5 years of related work experience. So to apply for the accelerated program, you have to have one of those prerequisites. It's also not offered in all departments. It is only offered in epidemiology, health policy and management, population, family health, socio-medical sciences, and general public health. We also have the MPH dual degree program. So let's say that you're interested in applying to another school at Columbia, like the social work school or the law school, and then you can apply as a dual degree student. So as a dual degree student, how you apply is you would apply to both schools during the same application cycle. And you would have to be accepted by both schools in order to begin a dual degree program. So once you're accepted by both schools, most students typically start at our partner school before later coming to Mailman and completing their MPH on an accelerated track. I will note that you cannot start an MPH dual degree program after already beginning your studies at Mailman. Because of the way the dual degree programs are structured, and because most of them start at the partner school, you can't start here and then decide you want to do a dual degree program. So we really encourage that if you're interested in a dual degree program, you need to apply to both schools in the same cycle. So enough with the MPHs. We also offer the MHA in 3 different formats. So we offer it in the part-time program, which is a 7-semester program that requires at least 1 year of relevant experience in a health-related industry in order to apply. In that program, students take classes 2 to 3 evenings per week, and it's about 2 classes per semester. We also have it in a full-time program format. It's 4 semesters plus a summer practicum. The only prerequisite for that is an undergraduate degree. You do not necessarily need health care related experience to apply for the full-time MHA, but it would help your application if you have some healthcare related experience. Those class times are day and evening classes, and it's typically around 5 classes a semester. Then we have the executive program, which is only in health policy and management. And so it is 6 semesters long. You have to have at least 7 years of relevant health-related experience in order to apply for the executive program. And those students meet Thursday to Sunday, 1 weekend a month, and it's 9 to 5 those days. And it's typically around 3 classes per semester. Then we offer the MS degree. So we offer it in 5 different departments, and within those departments, there are different tracks that you can take. So many of the MS programs are offered full-time and part-time, and the requirements for the work experience for the MS really vary depending on the department and the track that you're applying to. So I highly encourage you to look on the website and look at those differences. They also have different deadlines. So highly encourage you to look on the website for information about the MS degrees. We also offer doctoral degrees. So we have the DRPH and the PhD. And both offer opportunities to work with faculty, and they both have funding, graduate research assistantships and teaching assistance assignments that are available according to the department. So now in terms of our admissions requirements, so this is everything that you're gonna need to apply. So you're gonna need a resume or CV. You're gonna need a statement of purpose, which it is essentially one of the most important parts of your application. So your statement of purpose, you're really gonna wanna touch on why you're applying to Columbia specifically, why you're interested in public health, why the specific degree and department that you're applying to, because remember what I said earlier, the people reading your application are the people from the department that you're applying to. So you really wanna gear your statement of purpose to that department, because they wanna be able to read your statement of purpose and think, wow, they are really a perfect fit for my department. They wanna be able to see you in their cohort. So, and then you're also gonna wanna touch on what you want to do with your public health degree, so your long-term goals after graduation. Then you will also need to complete a SOFAS application. Give yourself quite a bit of time to complete the SOFAS application, because it can take quite a bit of time, longer than most people think. I would say about two, I think it's normally you have to manually enter your transcripts, so it can take quite a bit of time. So we are test optional in terms of test scores. The only applicants that need to submit test scores this application cycle are those that are interested in doctoral programs in the socio-medical sciences department. In all other degrees and all other programs, you do not need to submit test scores this cycle. You can if you want, but they are not required this cycle. However, all applicants will be asked questions of how to present evidence for quantitative and analytical writing abilities. So if you believe that you don't really have evidence of that, let's say you don't have any quantitative courses, you don't have publications, you don't have things that really showcase your skills as you would like them to be showcased, then we do encourage you to submit test scores if you would like. Then you also have to submit your transcripts. So you're gonna send them directly to SOFAS. And international students have to have their transcripts evaluated by WES. So we can't take international transcripts without them undergoing WES evaluation. And that is a lengthy process. You're really gonna wanna get started on that as soon as possible, because it takes time for WES to complete the transcript evaluation. In terms of your transcripts, if you have a low undergraduate GPA, or let's say there was a semester that was just really, really off for you, you can submit an addendum to your application. So this would really just be a document that you would attach to the application explaining some circumstances that you had going on during that time. And the committee will really take that into account. We do have a holistic review process. So please feel free to submit an addendum to your application if you feel you need to explain a part of your transcript. You also need at least 3 letters of recommendation. So academic advisors, professors, mentors, or supervisors should write your letters of recommendation. We do not encourage you to submit letters from teaching assistants. We really say stick to academic advisors, professors, mentors, or supervisors. If you've graduated within 5 years, One reference must be an academic reference. If you've graduated after, if it's been over 5 years since then we encourage you to submit an academic reference, at least one, but it's not required. Your letters must also come from professional email addresses. If you know that your professor or supervisor no longer has access to an academic email address or they can't use it, then please send us an email to request approval for this, and we will be reaching out to them directly to verify their letter of recommendation. Deadlines. So December 1st is our priority deadline for our master's programs. What I mean by priority deadline is those that apply by December 1st are the first to be considered for scholarships, and they are also tend to hear back before students that apply by the final deadline of January 15th. Also, please note that even though December 1st is the priority deadline for master's students, it is the final deadline for doctoral applicants. So then the next deadline is January 15th, which is the final deadline for the majority of our master's programs, for the MPH full-time, accelerated and dual, and the MHA full-time, and a couple of the MS programs. That's the final deadline that you need to have your SOFA submitted and really try your best to have all of your documents in as well. Some students have had their SOFA application submitted by January 15th, and then some of their documents come in later, like their transcripts, etc., which is technically okay. However, the further it gets out from the deadline, the worse it's going to be. So you really need try to have all of your documents in by January 15th. If they come in like a week or two after, it's not a huge deal, but the later it comes in, the worse it's going to be, because we can run out of space, and then your application can't be reviewed until all of your documents have been received. So have everything in by January 15th if you can. And then these are some of our other deadlines for our other programs. Again, would encourage you to look on the website for regarding the MS, because it can be a bit confusing with some of the MS, depending on the departments, they have different deadlines. Financial aid. So we do offer some sources of financial aid. So we have need, merit, mission, and endowment-based scholarships. We also have scholarships available for international students. We do not have a separate application for scholarships. All students are considered for scholarships when they apply. So you're really good. There's a part of the application where you're asked questions about like your future goals or your experience working with certain communities, and even a lot of people sometimes try and skip that part of the application because it's technically optional, but you really want to fill that stuff in because that will help you to be matched to scholarships and endowments, et cetera. So we also encourage you to look for outside sources of funding though. So we encourage you to look early because deadline dates can be pretty early. So they can be in October, November, December. So you're really going to want to get on that and start looking for outside sources of funding. And new sources of funding become available all the time. So you're going to want to look pretty often. And that concludes our presentation. So if you have any questions in the future after this presentation, please feel free to contact our admissions office at ph-admit@columbia.edu. Any financial aid questions can go to our financial aid office. Their email address is also listed there. And then again, if you want some more information, you can also check out our website, and we will be happy to help you. So that's all from me. So we are going to go into the student panel now. So we have our student here. I don't know if I have to, let me see, there we go. So we have our student Catherine is here with us. She has kindly given us some of her time. So Catherine, if you want to introduce yourself, you know, where you're from, your program and your year, and kind of your focus with public health.
Sure. Hey, everyone. Happy to be here with y'all this evening. I'm Catherine Squirewell. I use she, her pronouns. I'm a second year MPH student in the Population and Family Health Department, and my certificate is in Health and Human Rights. I'm originally from Atlanta, Georgia, so I've made my way up the East Coast to New York City, which has been an interesting and fun experience, definitely different than home. And my interests in public health really lie in, you know, advocacy, but really at the intersections of mental and maternal health, and kind of, you know, building out better access to mental health resources for expectant birth givers, and also you know, just kind of making sure that, you know, folks are attuned into like wellness and what that means for them, and building that access up for communities of color in particular. And so that kind of led me to my human rights, health and human rights certificate as well. And a lot of the population and family health classes, you know, rely around, you know, how can we be equitable researchers and help build out research projects that actually benefit the communities that we're trying to uplift. So, yeah.
Thank you. Can you tell us your favorite part of Mailman so far in your experience?
Yeah, I think so far, my favorite part has been connecting with the people. I think the students have been really amazing. And I think, you know, everybody talks about, oh, building your network, but I actually feel like, you know, coming in, even schooling during COVID, I was able to make some really great friends. And, you know, to be around folks that are so, you know, passionate about a lot of these topics and so, you know, educated, I think already, I think I'm learning so much, you know, from them as I am in the classes. And I also think the professors are really great. I've reached out to a lot of professors, you know, looking for, you know, internships or jobs or even just career advice. And all of them have been really helpful in terms of giving, you know, that kind of advice and that support. And if they didn't have the answer for me, they were quick to, hey, you know, connect you to another professor that could help out. So I just really appreciate the community that we were even able to tap in, you know, even given that we were schooling during like the pandemic and everything was online last year.
Yeah, I definitely think our students have acclimated very, very well to the online format, but I'm very grateful that you guys will be getting more of an in-person experience this fall. Can you talk about your practicum experience?
Yeah, so actually I'm at work right now. I'm finishing up tomorrow, but tomorrow will be my last day for my practicum. But I found my practicum through the Office of Field Practice that was mentioned earlier. So definitely utilize that as a resource if you all decide to come to Mailman. And I have a dual appointment with the Columbia Medical Center and also with New York State Psychiatric Institute. But my study that I'm working on is a research study called Triumph, and we're partnering with community health workers to implement depression screenings in churches in Harlem. And so it's been really awesome to be able to connect directly with the community. I've learned a lot from the community health workers. Many of them are from New York, like born and raised, and now they're in their like, you know, early 60s and 70s. So they have so much experience, not only, you know, with the communities, but also in kind of health and what that looks like and what the community needs and kind of advocating for them in that regard. So it's been great, like learning from them. And actually we rolled out the study this summer. So it's been really interesting getting to be a part of, you know, building up a study and, you know, trying to learn how to recruit participants during COVID, during a pandemic, when, you know, a lot of stuff isn't happening in person. I think it's been really interesting to try to connect with folks that way. But yeah, I think it's been, you know, our project, you know, really focuses on, you know, centering equity, community, you know, service, and also rigor. And I think that's really important. And those are the values that I was looking for, you know, in any job in particular, but I was really glad to be able to participate that even in a short-term kind of practicum experience. So it's been really great so far. And I guess if folks have any additional questions about practicums and stuff like that, feel free to drop those in the chat too.
Thank you. Which team within the Office of Education have you found most helpful and why?
Yeah, so I think that would be a tie between the Office of Field Practice and also the Office of Career Services. I think that, like I said, you know, with the Office of Field Practice, I was utilizing them mainly to connect with practicum sites. I think my initial thought was, you know, being able to find a practicum would be easier because I'd be able to float around and like, you know, go out and do community service projects because that's, you know, something that I'm, you know, really passionate about. And I would be able to connect with the community that way. But because of the pandemic, we were all inside and folks weren't, you know, they weren't having those types of projects anymore. And so it was great that the Office of Field Practice also thought that, you know, providing us opportunities to connect directly with the community were really important. And they sought those out to be able to advertise those to us. And so that's how I found this opportunity, which is really great. And then with the Office of Career Services, I've definitely utilized them to build up my LinkedIn page, learn how to network a little bit better and how to utilize, you know, my resume and my cover letters, I think, you know, how to tailor them, you know, per opportunity that you're looking into. So they've definitely combed through, I think, all of my kind of professional materials at this point. And so they've been really, really helpful. Setting up an appointment is really straightforward, really easy. So yeah, I think it's a tie between those two.
What advice would you give yourself going through the application process? If you could talk to your younger self and let them know what you would do.
That's a great question. I think, one of the things that when I started the program, I didn't actually, I think, so, you know, in undergrad, usually, you know, you're going into a really big program, you feel like you're a little bit of a number, you might connect with like one or two professors, and you're like, okay, well, you know, I'm at a big school, so it's, you know, no big deal. But I think what was interesting is when we first started, like, first week out, a lot of the professors, particularly in Pop Fam, since that's my department, a lot of them, as we were meeting with them over Zoom, they actually mentioned, you know, application aspects of the applications that they saw and thought were interesting. And so, like, you know, one of the things that I had mentioned in my application was talking about creating better access. And so for me, that was about like learning languages so that I can use, you know, them as a practitioner in the future. And so right now I'm like learning American Sign Language. And one of my professors brought that up and was like, oh, that was so cool that it was in your application. And I was like, wait, you remember that? And so I think, you know, folks really do read your statement of purpose. They want to see the passion. They want to see the things that you're into. You know, definitely include things that like you find that make you unique. I mean, even if you think they're like a little weird, I think that's what, you know, brings the diversity that we're looking for to the student population, and professors love that stuff. And so I think they're wanting to learn from you as much as you're wanting to learn from them. And so I think, you know, being able to convey that in your application is really, really important. And the other thing I will say is definitely, you know, look for strong letters of rec. When I asked my recommenders to write recommendations for me, I was like, can you write me a strong letter? Do you feel like you can actually speak to, you know, the type of student I am, the type of work ethic I have? And if that's not possible, thank you so much. I will find someone else. So I think, you know, taking those seriously is really important as well, because I think it says a lot if someone can speak very highly of you, you know, from a professional, you know, standpoint as well. So.
Yeah, to add on to that, actually, I completely agree. We've actually had some students in the past where they've had a letter come in that says they didn't highly recommend this student. So really be careful about who you're asking to write your letter is. You really want to make sure they're going to write you a great letter. And it's also not just a surface letter, but something that can really speak to you and your abilities. A lot of people get kind of hung up on needing to have a letter writer that's in the public health field or has public health experience. That doesn't matter as much as making sure that it's an academic person who can really speak to your abilities and write you a good letter. So I would just say, completely agree with everything she just said. So thank you so much, Catherine. So we will take questions from the chat, or if you want, you can also raise your hand. Just the little raise your hand function on Zoom, and we can do it that way as well. And I'll ask you to unmute and you can ask your question that way, or you can use the chat if you're more comfortable.
There's a question in the chat from someone for Catherine. What skills do you think Mailman has helped you really develop, and how have they been helpful in your practicum experience?
Yeah, that's a great question. Actually, so one of the classes that I had to take as part of Population and Family Health is research design and data collection. And we had to learn actually how to distribute, how to create and build in-depth interview guides, which, you know, you'll learn a little bit more about, you know, in the core. But we had to build and in-depth interview guides and then actually submit them. And so they were graded And then, you know, we got feedback about that. And I actually had to do that in my practicum this summer. So because this was a new study, it was something that we were developing, they were saying like, oh, you know, you have experience, you know, creating and distributing, you know, interview guides, which, you know, essentially that's when like, you know, part of the research team has a 101, you know, interview with a study participant. And so you're asking them really in-depth questions, trying to get at the larger research question of the study. And so I actually helped do that. It was me and one other team member, but I developed the interview guides that we're using in this study, which is really exciting. So that's one, I think, direct kind of skill that I was able to, you know, hone in on, which is awesome because I actually had that class in the spring semester, which is right before I started my practicum. And so I was like, oh, thank God I've done this and I did well in class and I took it seriously because now I have to do it professionally. And this is something, you know, that we had to submit to the IRB and like this is for, which is the Institutional Review Board. And so they're the ones that are like, you know, they comb through it and make sure it's ethical and make sure, you know, the participant, you know, it seems like logical for a participant to be able to answer those type of questions and everything. So yeah, everything went smoothly though. So I was glad I had that skill to pull from. So that's one example.
I see a question in the chat regarding LSAT scores. So yes, we do accept LSAT scores. You can submit them with your application. I don't believe that the LSAT will send scores to SOFIS, so you would have to send them directly to Mailman. So you would either send them physically to our address. It's on our website page, it's 722 West 168th Street, or you would send it via electronically to our email at ph-admit@columbia.edu. And they will take that into consideration. Regarding the priority deadline, those that apply by December 1st are considered part of the priority pool of applicants. I wouldn't say that you have a higher priority if you apply earlier than that, but your application might be read before the other applicants, but I wouldn't say you have a higher priority. You're still within the priority pool.
I would like to add that the committee doesn't usually review applications until after around December 5th. So it does get you in earlier, but honestly, it won't get reviewed until December.
I see some hands, so I'm gonna put there. Oh, I accidentally just lowered someone's hands instead of asking them to unmute. So you can re-raise your hand and I'll do that. But for now, Bella, what is your question?
Hi, I just have a quick question for Catherine or for anyone over there. What is some advice you had or would give yourself when you were writing your SOP for Mailman, like if you just look back to when you were actually writing it? Because I know a lot of us are in the midst, applications opened yesterday, and like we're in the midst of like really starting or looking at all the questions. So I'm just curious.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, the way I usually do my writing process is, you know, I write down like my values. So for me, I think, you know, one of the main reasons I wanted to go into public health, right, was like, you know, to uplift, you know, historically marginalized communities and to, you know, mitigate health disparities and things like that. And so I was thinking through, okay, so, you know, what are those values? And I made a list of that. And then I was like, well, how can I speak to that? And how can my experiences speak to those values as well? And I think that's how I planned out writing my statement of purpose. And so it kind of felt like storytelling, right? And you know, just making sure that you're weaving in, you know, those things that are very important to you so folks can get a sense of, you know, who you are really through through that part of the application. So.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Molly, what's your question?
Hi, how are you? Thank you for talking to us today. I'm going to be applying to Hillbrand, so all the information was really valuable. Thanks so much. I think are more application based. The first one is I'm deciding whether or not I want to do a certificate. Can I apply to the two-year and the accelerated so that I have the option, or do you have to choose one immediately?
So you have to choose one. You can only apply to one program per application cycle.
Got Got it. Okay, that makes sense. And lastly, I've been an ICU nurse for 5 years. That would be relevant experience for applying to the accelerated program, correct?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
Maya?
Hello. I put this in the chat already, but Catherine, am really interested in hearing more about your practicum experience. I thought that it sounded really, really cool and very relevant to some things that I'm hopefully interested in pursuing. I'm curious if you found it challenging to kind of establish a rapport with people in the community or get that community contribution and buy-in coming from an academic environment. And would be interested in kind of anything more you want to say on the practicum experience as well.
Yeah, thank you. That's a fabulous question. It is something that I think about all the time. So I'm really glad you asked it. I think that I was lucky enough that the PIs that I came in under already had a great relationship with the community. And so, working under their leadership and, centering, their kind of team values as well. In addition to mine, I think that's really helped us connect, at least with the community health workers. I will say that, in the few times that we've been able to get out into the community and kind of get more FaceTime and talk with them about, what is the Triumph study? Why are we, reaching out into particularly churches in Harlem and why Harlem and things like that. And so trying to, explain that to folks, I think just by nature of us being very genuine and very transparent, I think that has helped a lot. I still think that, mental health is something that's very stigmatized. And so we do, run into that, as we're talking to folks. But I think, generally they can walk away and say, you know what, even though I don't necessarily want to participate because, I don't think I identify with depression or some of those kind of key words, they can say that, I had a really great interaction with them. On that same kind of note, I am a part of Forward, the community initiative that was mentioned earlier in the presentation. And that's something we're thinking about as well. I think Columbia has, a fraught history, frankly, when it comes to, dealing and interacting with the community and, kind of co-opting land and figuring, so I think, when we recognize and acknowledge that history as well, and also we're trying to do something to, make up for that in whatever way we can, I think that's something that we center. And a lot of the students are very aware of that as we interact with community members. So I think, while it is, I think, difficult to reckon with, the institutional history and things like that, I think us coming in as individuals and being very transparent and very genuine and demonstrating to the community through actions and not so much words, it's more actions about, we're really here for y'all and we want to uplift you all and your voices and, give them seats at the table because they have voices, right? But I think they need a place to be able to use them and they need folks to listen. So I think that, them understanding that we want to take that role and we want to offer them that space is really important. And I do think that incoming students should be aware that, as you enter this community, you're going to be living in New York City. But I think, the medical center is centered in Washington Heights, predominantly community of color, which is really awesome. But also, understanding how do you respect that community? How do you come in and not co-opt anything? But it's like, how can I uplift what they already have going on, or what maybe they need going on and need support with? And also, doing that in Harlem because that's where main campus pretty much is. And so, thinking about that as you just make decisions with your programs and everything, understanding if I pick Columbia, that's something that I want to center as well. I think that's really important.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for speaking to all of that.
Thank you, Catherine. Really, really quickly, I saw some questions in the chat about fee waivers. So application fee waivers are all handled through SOFIS. The fee is actually their fee, so it's controlled by them. So you would want to go to them in regards to fee waivers. Also, there were questions about letters of recommendation. So letters of recommendation, if you graduated within 5 years, yes, we do require at least one of your recommendations to come from to be an academic recommendation. And if you graduated over 5 years ago, we encourage you to submit at least one academic recommendation, but it's not required. Also, you can submit more than three letters of recommendation. However, I would say keep in mind that the admissions committee is reviewing a lot of applications, and it is up to their discretion to review over three letters. So a lot of times people, when they submit over three letters, they will send us an email to let us know their like priority letters. So let's say that you submit five letters, but three of them are like, you know, they're really, really good. And you would, if they're only going to read three, you want them to read those three. Then you would let us know that, and we'll note that in your application. I see more hands. So one second, Maxine.
Hi. Let me see if I could. Okay. Can you guys, yeah, you guys can hear me. I just wanted to know, what are your like matriculation rates? So I'm definitely interested in public health, more so interested in underrepresented communities. And I have also looked at like the Human Institute of Nutrition that Columbia also has. I'm still trying to pick between the two, but my main goal is like, I wanna be a physician that works with underrepresented communities, mainly for like nutrition and like lifestyle changes and stuff. So I wanted to know, what is the matriculation rate for like, do you usually get medical students or like pre-medical students that wanna come into the program? Do you guys have those stats, or would that kind of fall under?
I don't have them offhand. I will say that most people who come to us with the intent of going to medical school typically go into like the MS program as opposed to like the MPH program. And they also are typically in like biostatistics department as opposed to like health policy and management. I don't have those statistics offhand. If any of my colleagues want to add on to that or have more information about that, please feel free to speak up. But I don't think I have those.
So most likely I would be more geared towards applying for the MS, which would be like the epidemiology, the toxicology, those programs would be kind of like safer. So yeah, because I'm just kind of trying to figure out which way to approach like my higher education, and like if I wanted to apply to the school, like what program I should apply to.
Yeah, I would definitely encourage you to book an appointment to speak with an admissions counselor to get more individualized attention, just because I do not have the statistics that you want on my hand at the moment. But I think that would be better for you to get more information.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, if I could just jump in. So Maxine, I think that's a great question. I'm actually also pre-med. I talk to a lot of students that, you know, now they're in like residency programs or whatever, and a lot of them have their MPH. And, you know, the logic I think behind that was, it's a different way of thinking. I think with, you know, an MPH, you're thinking, okay, how do these systems and structures like impact the community at large? And then as you know, particularly into medical school, you're learning how to deal with these problems at the individual level. But I think it does, you know, it's definitely up to you. I think, you know, yeah, definitely schedule, you know, with the admissions counselor and see what they have to say. But I think for me, one of the things I was thinking was like, okay, I need to understand these types of issues, you know, from the larger picture, and then be able to zoom in. Because if I start at the individual level and someone's coming in and I'm recommending, hey, take this medication and this medication and this medication, and every time I see them in my office, they're not taking it, I need to understand, okay, it's not because they're just, you know, not trying to be compliant, right? Like there could be barriers that, you know, prohibit them from, you know, being able to afford the medicine. Maybe they don't have insurance. Maybe they can't, you know, access those pharmacies, you know, so it's a lot of things I think that we talk about in public health that do help inform, you know, physicians' practice. So that's also something to consider, but it really depends on, you know, where your interests lie in terms of like, you know, what would you want to get out of an MPH that you think, you know, would inform your practice as a physician. But that was my perspective. In my decision. So
I did want to ask, do you have a card? Because it seems like you kind of have like, you're exactly where I'm interested in. So I don't know if you have like a card, an email that I could contact you and like we could discuss further too.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I'll drop my information at the in the chat.
Okay, yeah, sure. All right, yeah. Thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you, Catherine. Hold on, let me see. I don't want to butcher your name. Temi Tope, can you unmute? There we go.
All right. Thank you for this wonderful session. I'm actually a prospective student. I have a master's degree in environmental management, and I'm planning to apply to the PhD program in environmental health sciences. So I have a couple of questions, three questions precisely. The first one, as an applicant due to a PhD program, precisely environmental health sciences, do you have to secure an advisor prior to applying? That's one. Then two, in terms of a scholarship award, does the GRE or TOEFL come to play, you know, when awarding students scholarship? Then lastly, what's the student to faculty ratio in the PhD program?
So the student to faculty ratio, I believe I have that number pulled up. So our median class size is about 24. However, I believe that's a median for the school at large. And then we have 172 full-time faculty. With regards to funding, so doctoral students all have to secure funding. So doctoral applicants reach out to professors to see where their interests align. However, honestly, when it comes to doctoral students, your best course of action is to reach out to the department that you're interested in, because the doctoral programs are really managed by the departments themselves, and they have the most information when it comes to doctoral programs. So you said you're interested in environmental health sciences?
Yes.
Okay, so you are going to want to contact Dina Kulaki. One moment, if I can just pull up her line. So. Love a slow computer. It's so nice. Okay, here we go. So I will drop her information in the chat.
All right.
So you're gonna want to reach out to her, and she'll be able to give you the most adequate information when it comes to doctoral programs in environmental health sciences.
All right. Thank you very much.
Megan.
First. Thank you all so much for the presentation and for speaking on just the process and also your experience with Mailman. I am noticing, I think, throughout the description of each of the departments, I found my particular like desired area of study kind of straddling between population and family health and sociomedical sciences. And knowing that I need to pick one before submitting an application, I'm just wondering, like, are there opportunities to kind of overlap between the departments or find ways, particularly what I'm looking at is like wanting to focus on gender affirming care and reproductive health, but also doing that from a community-based perspective, involving a lot of like qualitative research and maybe some survey development. And so I'm trying to figure out like which would make more sense for what I'm hoping to accomplish. And just wondering, like, once I make that choice, is that's like the choice that I've made, but if there is opportunity to kind of explore a little bit some of the other things that the school is able to offer.
So when you apply, you do have to pick your department and your degree. I will say that those two departments is where we see a lot of people have overlapping interests, definitely. But even though you apply under that program, technically after your first semester, which your first semester is the students from different departments, so you will kind of have a glimpse into those other departments during that time. And typically there's a change of program period after your first semester where you can apply to switch departments. However, I will say it is not, it used to be very easy to switch departments. In the recent years, it has not been as easy, because when you are applying to switch departments, that department has to review your application. So a lot of times you have to submit an updated personal statement more geared towards that department. They'll review your application, and it's not a guaranteed switch. They can deny you, but you can apply at that time to switch departments.
Thank you.
And I would say definitely to look at the department's contact pages as well, and you can reach out to them and try and kind of get a fuller picture of where your interests most align. But also keep in mind the certificate component, that even if you are in a single department, you do still have the option to really kind of more specify your focus by picking a certificate that really aligns with your interests.
Great, thank you.
I think, oh, one more hand, okay. Lammy, can you unmute and ask your question?
Hi, thank you so much for having the session. I really appreciate all the advice that you've given everyone in the call. A question I had, I guess, for either is for students, like for incoming students, and particularly Catherine, like when you were coming into Mailman, what surprised you about the program? Because I mean, I know a lot of us, like, you know, we do our research to see like what, you know, Mailman can do for us and what we can also contribute to Mailman. But I was curious to hear your perspective on how Mailman has surprised you in, you know, shaping your perspective on public health or like what you want to do after graduation.
That's a great question. So I think a positive surprise was how like vocal and also influential the student body is at Mailman. I think, you know, Mailman takes into consideration the student evaluations like very seriously. So after you finish each course of the core and even in your second semester, after you finish all of those classes, you're able to give feedback about the professor, the course content, even the TA, they take those into consideration. And I know when I was coming in, we were notified of a lot of changes that were made based on like the prior year's like comments. And so that was really awesome to see. I think even some of the, like the Forward Initiative was a student led thing. Like so even that coming up and developing was something that students proposed and demanded and wanted to see built into Mailman so that there was like longevity to, you know, fighting oppression and in what ways we can kind of, you know, be anti-racist from an institutional perspective and like make those changes. And so that was student proposed and student demanded. And then Mailman, you know, took it on and was like, okay, yes. And so now students are very, very deeply involved in that program as well. So that was really awesome to see. I think an interesting surprise was that when we came in, I'm sure y'all remember like the events of, that summer. But I think there were a lot of changes made and I think a very pointed focus to, you know, anti-oppression work was, you know, like they're now attempting to integrate that more deeply into the curriculum. But I think I was a little bit surprised, especially because public health, you're dealing with communities all the time. I was thinking that understanding would have already been there from a teaching perspective of saying like, oh, these are things that we need to address. These are systems that we should address in practice and in, you know, curricula. And I think a lot of those changes are being made now, but it was interesting that it took so long. I mean, in all honesty and just being frank about that. And so I think, again, I think a lot of the students, you know, we're very vocal about, no, this is something we want to see. And, you know, we're paying for this, right? And this is the type of experience that we want students to have. And so now those conversations are more and more like happening more and more in the classroom. We see a lot more programming that's pointedly like anti-oppression work. And, you know, how can we integrate that into, how can we integrate that into the rest of our experience at Mailman? So it's nice that that's happening now, but I think I was surprised that it wasn't already ongoing as strongly as it is now.
Okay, yeah, and my other question would be, like, what are the opportunities for involvement within like Mailman or like also like with like with the greater like community around Columbia?
Yeah, that's a great question. So there are a ton of student orgs that you can join. And I believe there's like a student org fair that we're still gonna be putting on for incoming students. And so, you know, just, you know, check that out based on your interests. I'm actually a part of the Black and Latinx Student Caucus. I'm on the leadership team for that. So that was something that I was really passionate about, putting on programming that centers those communities and uplifting those communities. We also, there's a community service like aspect that the org is really proud of like having. And we had to pivot obviously because a lot of things were virtual. We had to pivot to moving those kind of opportunities online. But I think there are still ways to connect with organizations and things like online and offering them support in that way, which has just been interesting to learn and like engage with. But yeah, a lot of student orgs, I think, you know, feel free to come and like when you get to New York City, like just reach out to organizations that you're interested in working with, you know, tell them about your experience and why you want to work with them, why you want to learn from them. And, you know, I don't know, I'm really big on just kind of shooting your shot. So just feel free to reach out to different orgs and everything. I think they do appreciate the experience and the passion that male and students do bring, you know, even if we are connected to the institution. So I know a lot of folks have, you know, gotten opportunities to work directly with the community that way as well.
Okay, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Catherine. So we have reached the end of our time together. If you have more questions, please feel free to email us at ph-admit@columbia.edu. We also have another information session coming up. Just feel free to look at our website and familiarize yourself more with our programs. And we'll be here if you need any assistance. But thank you guys all so much for coming and attending our information session. And we look forward to reading your applications.